Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. Good day to all. I am Dr. Carmencita Padilla, one of the proponents of the Newborn Screening Program in the Philippines. Join me in uncovering the wonderful story of the newborn screening in the Philippines. Together, let's zoom in on what makes NBS a comprehensive program for every Filipino here at Newborn Screening in Focus. In the first season, we had an extensive discussion about the birth of the program in the Philippines, the collection and management of samples, the factors that might affect NBS results, how the NSC coped with the challenges brought about by the pandemic, and in detail, discussed the featured congenital disorders. In this second season, join us again as we dive deep into the systems of the Philippine newborn screening, study the partner organizations and their role in making NBS an outstanding program, and in detail, discuss some congenital disorders from the expanded newborn screening panel of disorders. This video series serves as an educational platform for our newborn screening coordinators, one in every 7,200 health facilities throughout the country. But just like all accomplished programs, the success of this video series relies on the consolidated effort of many sectors: the newborn screening centers, the satellite and continuity clinics, our partner organizations such as the DOH, PhilHealth, and the Centers for Human Genetic Services, and of course, many more. We hope that with your continued support, we'll be able to achieve our ultimate mission of setting a world-class newborn screening program in the country. So, without further ado, take a seat, get comfortable, as you're in for quite an adventure here at Newborn Screening in Focus. Kaya dapat magpa-newborn screening.
Opo, ma'am, meron talaga kasi hindi maiwasan. Then pag ano, pag ni-recall namin, ibang mga parents nag-accept na confirmatory, pero sa Genzyme ito kasi kami nag-refer kasi yun ang ano, yung isang facility na pwede silang mag-contact na confirmatory test. Kaya niya, pangalawang baby niya na, yung firstborn niya, G6PD, pangalawang baby niya is G6PD pa rin. So, ayong mga parents na yun, hindi na talaga nagpapa-confirm. Kasi sabi nila, yung panganay nga, G6PD, so, yun nga. Parang accepted naman lang din nila. Then, yun nga, advices lang.
Welcome to the 14th episode of Newborn Screening in Focus, where we talk about glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency or G6PD deficiency. The disorder had been formally included in the Philippine Newborn Screening Program since its adoption in 2000. It is the most common enzyme deficiency in the world, with around 400 million people affected. G6PD is an enzyme in the pentose phosphate pathway responsible for the prevention of cellular damage during oxidative stress caused by oxygen-free radicals. A deficiency in the G6PD enzyme makes red blood cells particularly vulnerable to oxidative stress, causing hemolysis when exposed to certain food or medications. Early detection and management is needed for G6PD deficiency to prevent its complications. To educate us more about G6PD deficiency, we invited two experts who have been studying this condition for a long time now. We have Dr. Maria Jasmine Gonzalez-Ruiz, and Dr. Jasmine is a pediatric hematologist and is currently the chair of the G6PD committee of the Newborn Screening Reference Center. She conducts her practice at Fedelmundo Medical Center and Rizal Uptown Hospitals. We also have Dr. Jocelyn Rosita, a pediatric hematologist and co-chair of Dr. Jasmine in the G6PD committee of the Newborn Screening Reference Center. She is the training officer of the Hematology Fellowship Program of the National Children's Hospital and attends at the Batangas Medical Center and Mary Mediatrics Medical Center. Dr. Jasmine and Dr. Joy, welcome to Newborn Screening in Focus.
Thank you very much, Dr. Manjit, for this invitation for us to join you in this very worthwhile activity.
Thank you, Dr. Manjit, for this invitation. We are glad to be part of this Newborn Screening in Focus.
So, Dr. Jasmine, let's start the conversation. What is G6PD deficiency?
All right. So, glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency is the lack of sufficient amounts of enzyme, the G6PD enzyme, which is a protein responsible for the protection of cells from destruction by reactive oxidative radicals. Unlike other cells that have spare proteins that can take over the function of the enzyme G6PD in its absence, red blood cells don't have alternative metabolic pathways, and therefore the red blood cells depend solely on this enzyme G6PD for its protection. Without the protective enzyme G6PD, red blood cells of the patients with G6PD deficiency are easily destroyed upon exposure to oxidative radicals. This is the most common enzyme deficiency in the world, and with high prevalence along sub-Saharan region, Mediterranean region, and Southeast Asia. This is the so-called G6PD belt, which is very similar to the geographic distribution of malaria because of the selection protection afforded by the enzyme deficiency. Thus, malarial parasites cannot survive in the G6PD deficient red blood cells.
Dr. Jasmine, since you mentioned malaria, can you just explain again to our audience the relationship of malaria and G6PD deficiency?
So in this region where malaria is endemic, the presence of G6PD deficiency confers protection against this population because malarial parasites requires this enzyme for their metabolism. So in the absence of this metabolic enzyme, then the red blood cells are in a very bad environment for these malarial parasites. And therefore, there is a decrease of this malarial load in the red blood cells. So they cannot cause detrimental effect to the red blood cells.
So since we're in the topic of malaria, Dr. Jasmine, so when a patient has a possible malaria, should we do any screening for G6PD then?
It is very important to screen patients potentially for treatment with anti-malarial drugs because anti-malarial drugs are included in the triggers, the drug triggers for G6PD deficiency. Exposure to these drugs can cause hemolytic crisis in patients with G6PD deficiency.
So thank you, Dr. Jasmine, and we're going to talk about the triggers later. But now, from Dr. Joy. Dr. Joy, this time, what causes G6PD deficiency, Dr. Joy?
G6PD deficiency is an X-linked recessive disorder. So only male patients will manifest the disease because they have only one X chromosome. And females are usually carriers because they have two X chromosomes. But they can also manifest the disease if both of their X chromosomes are affected. So for example, we have a mother who is a carrier and a father who is normal. For every pregnancy, they have 25% chance of having a son who is G6PD deficient, a 25% chance of having a son who is normal, and a 25% chance that their daughter is carrier, and a 25% chance that their daughter is normal. What about if the father is a G6PD deficient and the mother is normal? All the daughters of this couple will be carriers, and their sons will be normal. So that is the mode of inheritance of patients with G6PD.
You know, Dr. Joy, you know, I mean, with your explanation, it only shows that it's very important to explain to the parents once they have one child because of the many possibilities in a subsequent pregnancy. So thank you for explaining that to our audience because the knowledge of the result should lead to counseling of the parents prior to the next pregnancy. So thank you for that, Dr. Joy. So let's go to symptoms because I'm sure our audience are wondering, so what do we expect? Dr. Jasmine, tell us what to expect in terms of signs and symptoms among the patients with G6PD deficiency.
Babies born with G6PD deficiency appears normal at birth, and the majority will grow as normal and healthy as anybody else, unless, of course, he or she is exposed to significant oxidative triggers that may cause the hemolytic crisis or sudden red cell destruction. Patients react differently when exposed to the same triggers depending on the severity of the deficiency, the duration of the exposure, the amount of the offending triggers, and the strength of oxidative power of the substances. So it's very difficult to identify which among our patients would react severely and who among those who have mild or no symptoms at all.
I mean, that's interesting, Dr. Jasmine. You're saying that the trigger is one, the other one is the duration of exposure to the trigger and the amount of the trigger. So it's not as simple as saying, you know, I have G6PD deficiency and I probably will not have a reaction. There are many factors to the presentation of the child. So at birth, do we expect anything at birth? Yeah, the new mothers in the audience or, you know, our health professionals who want to know, are they expecting any significant signs at birth?
One of the critical symptoms, signs and symptoms that a G6PD deficient baby can have is during the neonatal period. When there is an incidence of exposure during the neonatal period, there will be a massive release of bilirubins from red cell destruction. And this is not cleared in the circulation because of the immaturity of the liver of the baby. And therefore, the accumulation of high levels of bilirubins, these are proteins that are very toxic to the young brain of the baby. And without adequate intervention and management, there will be long-term neurologic complications that we can observe among babies who had hemolytic crisis during the neonatal period.
But what I'm hearing from you, Dr. Jasmine, is you can have a baby who is positive for G6PD and was given triggers, which we will discuss later because there are many triggers that may be given to the baby. And since the baby may have an immature liver, then it can present, it may present with yellowing of the skin, with hyperbilirubinemia as a presentation in the child. But this does not happen all the time. Am I correct, Dr. Jasmine? Most of our patients go home without any symptoms. So what is the message we're saying? I mean, majority of our patients with G6PD actually go home without any signs and symptoms. So are you saying that there is only a subset of patients who may present as such? Because it is not a general observation that there are critical signs and symptoms at birth?
I agree, Dr. Amenchit. Not all patients born with G6PD deficiency will have the severe reaction during the newborn period. It depends on the severity of the deficiency. And therefore, it's very important to undergo the confirmatory testing that is mandatory for patients who screen positive for G6PD deficiency. Because in the confirmatory test, that is usually an enzymatic quantification of the enzymatic activity, we can more or less estimate the enzymatic activity and its severity. The lower the higher the deficiency, the more severe would be the reactions when exposed to these oxidative substances. For patients with mild deficiency, they can be asymptomatic, or if they may have reactions, they are usually just mild.
Because generally, most of the babies go home as normal babies, and there are no triggers to cause any hemolysis in the patients. So it's very important now to have a normal baby, to have a normal delivery without any exposure to any triggers, to make sure that they go home without any symptoms. But as you said, if ever the patient turns out to be positive, remember newborn screening, you need confirmation, you need to do the confirmatory test. So let me go to Dr. Joy. Dr. Joy, we've been talking about screening, but really screening for G6PD really just started in 2000. So how were we picking up the patients with G6PD before the year 2000?
Doctora, before I mentioned before the year 2000, only the hematologists know about G6PD. So they consider it in patients who will present with sudden onset of hemolysis, T-colored urine, and then hyperbilirubinemia. So that's the time that a hematologist can consider G6PD. But now, because of the start of this newborn screening project, most of the doctors, not only the hematologists, but also the pediatricians, the family doctors, and everybody knows now about G6PD. So we are very lucky that this G6PD deficiency was added in the newborn screening program in the Philippines.
Okay, so they come sick, in other words, with symptoms. And that's how we pick up that they have G6PD deficiency. So thank you to the newborn screening program. Now they don't have to have that kind of complication. So Dr. Joy, so what is the management of G6PD deficiency if you turn out to be positive? What is, how do you manage the patient?
As Dr. Maha or Jasmine said earlier, patients with G6PD deficiency are usually asymptomatic. So there's no management to be done initially if they are asymptomatic. They just have to prevent from being exposed to the triggers that can cause hemolytic crisis. So
okay,
that is,
so Dr. Joy, tell me, what are these triggers that we've been talking about? It's maybe time to tell them what are the triggers for patients with G6PD deficiency.
Actually, the triggers Dr. mentioned is in our website. There's a lot of drugs, food, and other chemicals that can interact with the patient that can cause hemolytic crisis. So we'll just start first with the drugs. So for mostly the drugs are the sulfas. And these sulfas are usually used to treat UTI or some respiratory infection like your cotrimoxazole, and then other drugs such as what Dr. Jasmine has mentioned earlier, the anti-malarial drugs are also contraindicated in patients with G6PD. So these are the drugs that usually cannot be given to patients with G6PD deficiency. The food list of G6PD deficiency is quite long, but we would like to emphasize that the fava beans, which is present in some of the nuts being sold in our supermarkets, can cause hemolysis in patients with G6PD. As also the naphthalene balls, which were used before in the diapers of babies, because to prevent the insects from going to the diapers of the babies, were usually used, but now I don't think they are still using naphthalene balls. But these are the possible triggers that can cause hemolytic crisis. And also, please do not forget that also infection, such as the fever or any viral infection, can also cause hemolytic crisis in patients with G6PD. So patients with G6PD deficiency should consult a doctor or their pediatrician if ever they have some symptoms of fever or any infection.
So Dr. Joy, if ever, you know, this happens that they have the crisis, what is the treatment?
If ever the patient will develop crisis, the treatment is usually blood transfusion. And of course, they have to go to the nearest hospital for the blood transfusion because blood transfusion cannot be given in the clinics. So they have, sometimes this patient, or most of the time, these patients will be admitted for blood transfusion and also for monitoring the patient's hemoglobin to check if there's already increase in your hemoglobin so that we can send the patient home, or we can already send, we can also tell the patient that this drug should not be given again or to this patient.
You know, just listening to the long list of triggers in terms of drugs, food, and naphthalene balls, there's so much to talk about, but the time is so short for us. So we'd like to maybe at this point request Dr. John and Dr. Jasmine to give some special messages to our viewers. And we promise you that we will have another episode on G6PD deficiency. So I'll start with Dr. Jasmine. What do you want the viewers to bring home from this episode?
So my take-home message for all our listeners and viewers would be, it's very important to keep a list of the oxidative foods, drinks, and chemicals to avoid that can trigger the hemolytic crisis among G6PD deficient patients. And as mentioned by Dr. Joy, a complete list is posted on the official newborn screening website. Also, I would like to emphasize that infection is one of the most common triggers. Do not ignore fever. And when you do physician consults, always mention and always inform the doctor that your patient has G6PD deficiency in order to avoid being prescribed with drugs that are contraindicated for G6PD patients. Also, be able to identify early signs and symptoms of the hemolytic crisis, such as sudden paleness, we have headaches, dizziness, also the yellowing of the eyes and the skin, which we call jaundice. Patients can also present with shortness of breath and weakness. And a very particular sign that we watch out for is the presence of dark tea-colored urine, which is a very definite sign that the patient is undergoing a hemolytic crisis. And also, when these signs and symptoms are identified, bring your patient immediately, either to the hospital or to your doctor. Knowledge is power. Educate your child as he or she grows up to be mindful of what he eats, what he drinks, and what chemical to avoid.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jasmine. Dr. Joy?
Tara, Dr. mentioned, I just want to emphasize the importance of the confirmatory testing. Because now we have a problem. A lot of patients are being tested positive for G6PD, but they don't undergo confirmatory testing. The importance of confirmatory testing is very important because we don't want to label this patient as G6PD deficient if he is not really G6PD deficient. So now, as part of our project, the G6PD experts is conducting a research regarding the causes or the reasons why the parents are not using this confirmatory testing, which the confirmatory testing centers are located all over the Philippines. So it is really accessible to all patients and parents that they can have this confirmatory testing done. So that's what I want to emphasize, Doctora, the importance of this confirmatory testing.
Well, thank you very much to our panelists for our lively discussion on the genetics and the overview of G6PD deficiency. And we are excited to see you again next week as we further discuss the long-term outcomes of G6PD deficiency. G6PD deficiency is the most common enzyme deficiency in the world. And newborn screening plays a very important role in the early identification of the patients with G6PD deficiency, leading to early management and prevention of hemolytic crisis. Once G6PD deficiency is confirmed, its management is mainly avoiding the food and drugs contraindicated in the patients with this condition. We hope that this episode has provided you with basic medical facts about G6PD deficiency that will help you talk to your patients and their families. Kaya dapat mag-newborn screening. To our virtual audience, please send us your comments, questions, or the list of topics that you want us to cover in our succeeding episodes. Email us at info@newbornscreening.ph or you may tweet us at newbornscreenph and also include the hashtag ENBSPH. We continue to improve our services as deemed necessary by the emerging challenges through an open dialogue about our experiences in newborn screening. It is our hope that through this video series, we extend the sharing of knowledge with greater reach, empower our frontliners, improve connectivity with newborn screening coordinators, and most importantly, provide unparalleled service to every family. That wraps up our discussion about G6PD deficiency and its basics. Let us tune in to know the cases of patients going through a hemolytic crisis next week. This and more here in Newborn Screening Focus. Nothing is more precious than seeing a child grow healthy and normal. Let's realize this through newborn screening. Newborn screening is a gift of life.
Na magpa-NBS ilang patak ng dugo ang kailangan para magawa ang test. Makalipas ang 24 oras pag si baby lumabas, gawin natin ng NBS alin sunod sa batas.
Oh, I'm a baby, isa kang blessing, kaya dapat magpa-newborn screening. Oh, I'm a baby, isa kang blessing, kaya dapat magpa-newborn screening. Suka.